As we speak. So I'd like to now welcome my next guest here to the Navigant Credit Union Broadcast Center. I do believe that Dr. Charles Steinberg, the president of the Pawtucket Red Sox, is in the building and around the corner. Dr. Steinberg, come on in.
How are you?
I appreciate you taking your time today.
Well, my pleasure.
Coming to the studio here as we bring to
folks. It's baseball season.
It is baseball season, and literally an hour before you came on, got the release from the Pawtucket Red Sox about the second class for Hall of Fame. Do you
that?
Want to unveil it? Do you want me to unveil it?
How about you do it? You be the play-by-play. I'll do the color commentary.
Okay, the color commentary. Let's start with the players, Carlton Fisk and Mo Vaughn.
How about that? So,
a couple of big names.
Yes, and we're very excited. And number three?
Former manager, Joe Morgan.
How about that? A very beloved fellow. And all three are characters. You know, they all three have personalities, have moments, you know, things that you remember. And you know, their journeys to the big leagues, journeys to the Hall of Fame in some cases, to the Red Sox Hall of Fame in some cases, included Pawtucket in a meaningful way. And so we're eager to celebrate that. It was really one of the first things that we did. We, you know, a number of us just joined the Paw Sox a year and 3 months ago, and our executive vice president, general manager Dan Ray, said, let's create a Paw Sox Hall of Fame. We didn't know there hadn't been one. And so it's good news, and it lets us reminisce, but also hopefully see all three guys again at a game or games in Pawtucket this summer.
I was going to ask, is that to be determined shortly,
yes,
how that's going to all play out?
You know, we go through the actual simple process of logistics. Okay, where are you then?
Can we get all three cats at the same
yes,
time?
Yes, it's exactly right.
The cat herding.
So I think we have a couple dates that Mo Vaughn is good, and I think there are a couple July dates. Now we're checking with Carlton to see when he'll be here. And then Walpole Joe is right up the road, so we hope that it'll work out for him. But you know, if all three are there on the same day, that's a cool day. If you spread it out and do three independent inductions, that's cool too. It's just nice when people come back to town, and what I like is when a grandparent or a parent can take their child to the game, and you know, you tell the 8-year-old the story of Fisk's home run, or you tell the 10-year-old about Mo Vaughn's opening day grand slam, or you tell them about Joe Morgan managing the longest game in the entire history of professional baseball, and he'd gotten thrown out of the game and was peering through a little crevice to watch the games through the 32nd inning before it resumed a couple months later. So those, when baseball allows you to foster intergenerational conversations, and each of these three electees, soon to be inductees, they inspire those kinds of conversations. And I think that moms and dads and grandparents are looking to have those conversations with the 14-year-old.
To be able to do that. We'll be keeping an eye as to when the Pawtucket Red Sox do honor their Hall of Fame inductees. Carlton Fisk, Mo Vaughn, Jim Morgan, just announced today, so
yes,
we'll be keeping an eye on that. Have you been down to Florida much? What's the roster? Are we going to get some Sox players, some Red Sox players for the time being? How's it shaping up?
I only did a little dabble. I only went down there for a weekend, saw a game. But it did feel like half of Rhode Island was there. It was amazing how many people I met. A Paw Sox fan, I'm a Paw Sox fan. I'm like, oh, that's terrific. So, you know, some are snowbirds, and some were just down visiting, and but the passion was high. But I think that there is no question that it's going to be an interesting season for the Boston Red Sox.
Mm.
That flows right to the Paw Sox.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, there are people who talk about the year, the spring, that Sam Travis had. Some people didn't know whether he was even going to be able to play at spring training because he was recovering from the surgery, from the injury that he had last May.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he not only played, he played beautifully. Nobody seems to question his bat. And now there was a question, well, could he still even make the team? Well, they said, well, there's no slot for him right now. So you've got a player coming to Pawtucket right now who all eyes are going to be on, you know? And then you have... I remember last year we were watching Devin Marrero play shortstop, and he made this defensive play. Whoa! I mean, that's not just a major league play, that's a gold glove play. So you're going to have a roster that is populated not only with major league caliber players. What you're seeing these days, and it's one of the reasons that it's so great for Pawtucket to be 45 minutes away from Fenway, is you see the roster. It's almost like the AAA club is an extended roster of the big league club. You see so much movement going back and forth. So you may be watching a Boston Red Sox player who's coming to Pawtucket for a couple of days. You may be watching a Pawtucket player who, after the game, is getting the call. There is quite a shuttle. So I think to be able to do it and see it for $6 if you're a kid or a senior, or $9 for adults, or if you want to go big, $13, $14, fine. Don't forget, this year, fireworks every Saturday night.
Fireworks every Saturday night. It's
Yes,
always a
after
big
every Saturday home game.
after
Yes,
it's always a
Saturday night
big
home
draw
game.
at the 4th of July now, after every Saturday.
Well, fans told us we love the fireworks. You all do fireworks really well. Not that we do. That's a long history that Ben Mondor and Mike Tamboro had. So Mayor Grebian and Pawtucket's been just great to us, and we said, look, our fans are telling us that they enjoy the fireworks nights. And there's something reliable about knowing every Saturday night there's fireworks. Now, maybe you want to come to Beatles fireworks, which I do on June 17th. It's a really cool medley of Beatles songs. Or maybe you want to go to Taylor Swift. We know this, that everybody.
Oh, so it's set to music.
Yes, the
Okay.
fireworks set to music, Beatles, Taylor Swift, Star Wars, and the Star Wars one is the one that shot out of the gate. Really amazing. See, Star Wars is hot. And if you listen to the parents, they'll tell you what their kids want. Or listen to the children.
Now, you were just mentioning, the back and forth between Pawtucket and Boston. Do you see the spike when you get the big Boston players come down, attendance-wise?
Yeah, I'm told that you do. We didn't see that many Boston players come down this
That's
past
true.
year. So I always was looking at it on the other side for my many years where I was only with the Boston Red Sox, where, a player would go, you would
What
say
would
down,
happen
go
when
down to Pawtucket, and you'd hear, oh, it was a good spike. But yeah, I think it is cool because we know that going to Fenway, it's an investment. That's the fine dining establishment that you may go to a couple times a year. Whereas coming to a Paw Sox game, that's your, I hope, your friendly family dining restaurant that you go to a few times a week. So the idea that whomever's going to wear the David Ortiz mantle, whether it's Dustin Pedroia or Mookie Betts or Xander Bogaerts or Jackie Bradley Jr., and we're not hoping that they have an injury that brings them down, but if you hear that they're going to be back in the neighborhood and I can see them for $6 or $9, yeah, I hope that's still cool. It feels cool to me as a baseball fan.
So one of the things the Pawtucket Red Sox did just do in conjunction with the state and Pawtucket was put forth a report about the upgrades that McCoy would need, what that would cost, what building a new McCoy would look like. One of the things not included was the look at the Apex location, which has been reported. You've been in talks with the owners. Why look at the Apex location? What would the Apex location, why did that catch your eye?
Well, I think the sequence is this. The first thing is, this is the 75th anniversary of McCoy. It's a 75-year-old building. And it is undeniable, especially on a rainy day, that it needs repair. I don't think anybody questions that. If you do question it, come try to use one of our meeting rooms on a rainy day and you can't. Okay. So what was key was for the Paw Sox to walk hand in hand with the city of Pawtucket, hand in hand with the state of Rhode Island, all three together to say, let's all agree on an independent assessment. Okay. So everybody agreed on the credibility of an independent assessor who says it will cost $68 million to bring it up to standards, 78 if you wanted to knock it down and rebuild it. Except in each of those two cases, the report said, you wouldn't find the surrounding development that you get often with new ballparks that are well designed and well placed. And Lucchino invented that concept with the Camden Yards back in 1992,
So,
which
hence the look at the location closer to the highway and the apex location.
that's for the city to take a look at, and not for us. And that's what the distinction is. Your question is, where does a ballpark do the most good for a city? And the answer to that question, to me, we turn to the leader of the city and say, where does it do the most good? Pawtucket is on the verge of a renaissance. Pawtucket has the potential to completely revitalize. There's a lot going on. You got a train station that's coming, a new brewery that's coming. People are investing. There's been public investment and there's been now private investment. Where would it do the best? And I think people look at the Apex site as this, you know, gigantic crater in the landscape of the heart of a city, mm-hmm. and say, well, would you like a venue that brings 500,000 baseball fans and other concert goers and, you know, other year-round activities? That's where the question comes. But to me, that's a public policy decision of where does a ballpark do the most good? And that's why that's one of the sites, and that's why that's the question.
Now, how big is that footprint? I know that, you've had discussions. Is the footprint big enough for just a ballpark? Would it be big enough for the ballpark and development around it? Just for a sense of folks who might not know or drive around or know that there.
We are so close to me getting way out of my area of knowledge and expertise, so I'll try to tell you what I know, but try not to go beyond. But yeah, you can fit a ballpark there. There's also room in the adjacent areas for the parking that you're going to want, mm-hmm. and that's going to be necessary. You don't build a ballpark unless there is a parking plan and a traffic plan. And we have very extensive experience doing that in our other cities. So that's a fundamental. But yes, if you bring 500,000 people to a venue, April through September, call it, or August or September, and you design it with wintertime uses so that you have year-round vibrance, so that you have uses when the team's on the road in the summer, with concerts, which we want to bring back to McCoy now, then you know that in a downtown that is on the verge, on the cusp of revitalization, you can inspire more private business to repopulate your town, and having a vibrant Pawtucket is good for everybody.
What would a stadium at that location cost?
You know better than I do.
I certainly don't.
That goes way out of my area, and I'm happy to not know that. But what you first have to look at is where would it do the most good. Then you figure out, all right, how big would it be? Then you figure out your costs.
So I just want to harken back to the report done of what renovations would cost and what a new McCoy would it be akin to that, or again, is it just because there's auxiliary other areas to consider with a whole new development?
You know, a few weeks ago, Dave Dombrowski, the president of baseball operations for the Red Sox, and Sam Kennedy, the president of the Red Sox, were meeting some of the fans and sponsors of the Paw Sox. And they were imagining, oh, what if it were Fenway on the inside and Rhode Island on the outside? Well, as a player development facility, wouldn't you have liked Mookie Betts to have learned the Fenway outfield before he even went up? So
you talk about Fenway, and like we're talking about the footprint, mm-hmm. like a literal replication.
Yeah. What if you did
of the left field and
that
right
was
the, field?
That was their.
Would there be a green monster?
That was their suggestion. So at least all it does is it gets you imagining. It's not as though you need to replicate what was, but you can preserve all that's good about what you have. For instance, if there were a ballpark in downtown Pawtucket, Ben Mondor was a curator extraordinaire, and there is this magnificent hall of history, although it's normally only open to the suite holders. Mm-hmm. We're going to have an open house on April 8th, 11 a.m. 2 p.m. free. Bring the kids.
So open the park and see the.
Yes.
Okay.
But all of that can transfer. So you don't lose that. And I know what you lose when you go from venue to venue. I didn't know what Larry Lucchino was talking about in 1992, opened in 92 when he built Camden Yards. I loved the stadium of my youth. But I have to admit, Camden Yards was awesome, is awesome, celebrating its 25th anniversary, and has been an undeniable international sensation.
So let's talk time frame, and we'll talk a few other things as well. The lease at the current location is through 2020?
Yeah, through the 2020 season.
Through the 2020 season. So how soon do you anticipate having to make a decision, an announcement, really making that call as we're here in 2017?
I don't know that you go by the lease as much as you go by the dynamic in the city. And that's why I turn it back over to our civic leadership. There's something good going on in Pawtucket. You can feel it. I'll tell you this. In just my year and 3 months with the Paw Sox, the pivotal relationship has been with Mayor Gremian. He has been the one who is approachable, who has been kind, who has been helpful, who has been responsive. When we launched in November our Paw Sox Scholars Program, and we wanted to choose a child from Pawtucket, he said, all right, to get a college scholarship. He said, pick one from Central Falls also. All right, good. He said, we're partners, our cities are really siblings. So you have this eighth grader from Pawtucket and an eighth grader from Central Falls who are each getting a $10,000 college scholarship from the Paw Sox Foundation. Mayor Gremian was instrumental in that. So you go by him, he's the one leading the city and giving us guidance. But there is an opportunity, and you don't know how long that opportunity is going to exist. You've got other businesses all investing or on the verge of investing. So you have to let him conduct this orchestra.
And you point to Mayor Gremian, but as we know, folks were up at the State House talking with the new Senate President, Dominic Ruggiero.
Sure.
Clearly the state has a stake in,
yes,
from the last time when there was an ask made to the state. How soon, are we on the verge of hearing some more news or development from the Paw Sox ownership? Especially the tipping off the visit to the State House has raised a lot of eyebrows, saying, sure, are they going to come back with another ask?
Well, I think the one thing you have to do is build the relationships. And I think that what you saw there was the meet and greet there. I don't think that tells you what the timetable is. For me, professionally, my timetable is focused on the baseball season.
Mm-hmm.
That's our urgency. But I leave it to Lucchino, I leave it to Mayor Gremian, the governor, the other electeds from the state. They'll know what to do. But that I can't tell you. I can just tell you that we crave having that warm, hospitable environment where parents and grandparents bring their kids and you build the memories, because the fondness with which they talk about memories, it's very healthy for a community. I love it, and I've loved it in every city in which I've been blessed to live.
So let's go back again, though, to the state, and if the Paw Sox ownership does come and say, we do need some assistance from the state to make this happen. Last time, obviously, the effort was not successful. You do know that there is a vocal opposition out there to any state investment. How do you envision coming forth and making the case for it this time around?
Well, I don't. I'm not. That's not what that wouldn't be my area of expertise today to tell you. But I don't know that the premise is valid. I think that everything about 2015, there's been a 180. 180 degree turn. Sadly, because Jim Skeffington passed away, and that was his vision. His vision was, a ballpark in Providence. He adored Providence. Lucchino loves having a ballpark that helps the city, whether it was Baltimore, whether it was San Diego, Boston, or all the progeny in Major League Baseball and minor league baseball. The ones that make your city better, that we actually care about. How do you make sure that there are abundant public benefits by a well-designed and well-placed ballpark? That's mm-hmm. that's really what we look at. There was an ask before. I don't know that you're looking at an ask. I think you're looking at what's the best way that we all continue to work hand in hand, three, the Paw Sox, the city and the state, hand in hand, to do what is actually best for Pawtucket and the state. I think it's a more fundamental question that you have to ask.
Do you think it needs to necessarily, you said there wasn't, the lease expiration in 2020 isn't driving it, but we're here in 2017, Next year's an election year in Rhode Island. Obviously, a lot of political pressure comes with that. Do you see something moving forth this year? You know, we asked the same question with the marijuana debate. It's an issue that has political ramifications.
It's another issue of which I know remarkably little.
Well, what I'm mentioning is folks are talking about the sense of urgency by the lieu of the fact that in an election year, things just get so trumped up, for lack of pun.
I think your question's very fair. I think I'm pretty sure that I don't know the answer. I think that the crystal ball through which I would be looking is one where I would only be guessing. But again, I understand the question. I think you're talking about future events that I just don't know.
Okay. And I just want to talk, let's go back to the mixed use potential, as you said. If you look to build a new stadium and you talk about winter use, were we talking other sports? It would look like a Fenway with hockey. Could there be soccer? What's the potential that was, you know, that you talk about for if you could use a stadium year round?
You know, you do what's best for the city. When we built Camden Yards in Baltimore, it was intentionally for it to be a baseball only ballpark.
Okay.
You got fined by Lucchino if you used the S word, and you used it. A stadium. No, he'd say, no, we want a ballpark.
Okay.
Well, and he loves building ballparks. Now, today, if you look at how to best benefit a city, how to best benefit a region, and you want to have year-round uses, you can build a beautiful ballpark and have year-round uses. Look at what we've done at Fenway.
Oh, Fenway. I mean, the amount of activities, the ski jumping, the ice hockey.
Exactly. And there's no denying that it is a quaint and quintessential ballpark. So you see what can be done.
And I know you said, don't mention the S word, don't mention stadium. Are there any examples of minor league baseball that do mixed use baseball, soccer, or is that very
uncommon? I don't know about soccer. So you're asking, again, a very fair question. I just don't know the answer. Mm-hmm. I know that there are good examples of new ballparks in comparable minor league, in comparable cities that have minor league baseball that have been very successful. And it's not just the sports that you use. You can have other activities there. My goodness, the wedding business at Fenway Park is amazing.
I've seen that, people getting married there.
It's amazing. The entire, we wound up creating a department called Fenway Enterprises, and now we have McCoy Events, but you can have your weddings there, but it's more than weddings. You have companies have their picnics, they have their outings, but yes, you can have sports too. But you're dealing with a big plot of grass, and the imagination and new groundskeeping techniques in a new ballpark can let you do it. Let's remember, the Red Sox won the 2004 World Series. You remember that? That was a good one. All right.
So, that was a good one.
After that, we removed the field, right? Because there were so many rainouts, and put in a new field starting in 2005. With a modern drainage system. And I don't know that there was a date lost to rain after that. Whereas if you compare this past year at McCoy, we had a fireworks night. It was a Friday night and it poured right before the game. And it rained so hard that when it stopped raining and we still had sunshine, we suddenly had a warning track that was a lake and we couldn't play the game. Luckily, we could still have the fireworks because it was a beautiful night. But that's a game that wouldn't have been rained out if you had a new
clearly something
a new field.
That would
and,
be considered
yeah,
a
new Larry,
stadium.
Larry and Janet Marie Smith, the architects, you know, the partnership that created Camden Yards, instituted this in 1992, and I think it's been improved upon since then. It's called prescription athletic turf. So you have a sand-based system, so that the water seeps through the way water does on the beach. And what that does is it opens you up to the possibility of various sports with healthy turf. Mm-hmm. And you can have your ball games, and if lacrosse is the right answer, if soccer is the right answer, if that's going to bring vibrance, vitality, energy to Pawtucket. Let's go.
Children and the kids.
Yeah.
So you mentioned that was it the April 8th event, which was
Yeah,
So
so
talk to us what's coming up. You know, here we are, end of March. What do we expect in April in Pawtucket?
So we were going to have an open house tomorrow, but the weather suggested that we wait a week. So that's fine. So Saturday.
So next week.
That's right.
Mark your calendars.
Saturday, April 8th from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. We'll open the park. Come and see it. Take a walk around. See, you know, maybe your child wants to go and touch that grass. Don't tell the groundskeeper that I said so, but, you know, just touch it in foul territory. Take a walk on the warning track, sit in the dugout, see the bullpens, go up and tour the press box, and go see our Hall of History. Inspire those intergenerational conversations. That's just fun. It's free, and we'll provide lunch if your definition of lunch is a ballpark hot dog.
So, for many folks who go to a park.
It is, you know.
That's what it is.
But then our opening week starts on April 10th with an evening game, 6 o'clock, an hour earlier than it has been in the past, because we figured that the temperature will be warmer from 6 to 7 than it will be from 9 to 10. Mm. So if you figure, you know, 6 to 9, come to the ball game. Header.
Oh, wow.
And one of the days that I'm intrigued by is Wednesday. That's the 12th, because it's an after-school game. It's a 4 o'clock game. Uh-huh. We're calling it Grandparents' Day. And that stems from the following. Talking to fans, I would walk out to the berm or just walk around the stands and just talk to people, ask them where they live, where they're from. So many times we found that we were talking to very active, youthful grandparents who play vital roles in families. You know, these are baby boomers, and they're very, you know, it's different from what grandparents seem like when we were kids.
That is true.
And they pick up the kids after school because maybe both parents are working.
Yep.
And so we thought, let's have a grandparents' day where it's after school. The grandparents are picking the kids up anyway. And how cool for grandma to sit there with her grandson or her granddaughter or grandfather, you know, you pick, you know, mix and match, and tell the stories of baseball. And we'll come up with some, you know, fun incentives, some good things to make it, you know, worthwhile, like do something in our gift shop in the Paw Sox baseball store.
Have you done a Grandparents' Day before?
No, not that I know of. And so I thought, let's do that. So it's after school, and that's the key. You know, we hope the weather's nice. At least 4 o'clock, it'll be warmer than it's likely to be at, you know, at 9 o'clock that night. So that, but every day there's something special. There's a plain old matinee at noon on Thursday, and we'll have giveaways on Friday nights. And then once we get to April 29th, that's the first Saturday night game.
Is that the first fireworks game?
That's the first fireworks game. So we'll do that, and our games are going to be televised every Saturday night on My Rhode Island TV. So it's an opening night too. So we're trying to include more people and reach out to more people. And if we can make it comfortable for moms and dads to bring the kids, that's actually what we love to do, because that grows the game and it helps the conversations in the families. Plenty of parents tell us that baseball is still sometimes the only thing that the 15-year-old will open up about, you know, and if you can play that kind of sociological role, we know that you can play a psychological role in the health of the city, and you can do something that benefits the economy of a city with baseball, that's good.
I hit a double at McCoy this past summer.
You hit a double.
It wasn't a real double.
Well,
it was the Jeffrey Osborne Softball Classic.
Yes.
Magic Johnson was pitching.
Right.
I hit the tiniest little dribbler that I knew stayed in.
Go on.
I ran to first.
Yes.
I ran close to the first baseman.
Right.
Because I knew I could scare them to not catch the ball. I went over the first baseman's head. I ran toward second base. And I slid into it.
We call that a little league double.
And I liked it out.
But you faced Magic Johnson.
But when I faced Magic Johnson, do you know what he did? He did one of these to everyone. He did the come in, it's a girl.
Yes. And you showed him. You doubled.
So that the Jeffrey Osborne Softball Classic was a very popular event, very well attended with a, you know.
Now Magic has his hands full because he's got new responsibilities with the Lakers, so don't know if we can get
him. If we can get him back. Magic, right. If you're listening, Jeffrey Osborne's going to put the pressure on.
Jeffrey was great to work with. Smokey Robinson was the coolest. Oh my God.
Smokey was great. I don't think he, you know, he was out there.
It was great. We're talking about, you know, writing the music and the lyrics to My Girl. And, you know, it's like, wow.
Oh, and I caught a foul tip from Dr. J. I
did. You had a big day.
I had a big day. You know, my stock went up.
All right. We want to have you come out to a Paw Sox game and have the same kind of thrill. I'm not saying that you're going to hit in that game. But you might catch the foul ball.
I'll have a hot dog. Well, anything else you want to tell folks while you're in here in studio, Dr. Stenberg?
No, we do. By the way, we are adding some more culinary items. We'd like to have some new diamond delicacies. But we also like to hear from fans of what they want. Because I didn't realize that you can get any sandwich that we have with gluten-free rolls.
That's very important to me.
Well, and to many people. So we have that.
Okay.
I didn't realize that. And you know, we're talking about how to augment vegetarian options too, but gosh, so many people say, just give me the hot dog, give me the what are we doing? We're doing buffalo chicken salad, buffalo chicken sandwich, every version.
Buffalo. Buffalo's very popular.
New, you know, fancier nachos. So I know that the staples are still what people like, but we are looking to make sure that the menu items that we have are resonant with the residents. And we like to hear. We have an email address, fanfeedback@pawsox.com. And we like to read every email, and you know, some are very nice. Some, you know, can have a little, you know, Rhode Island bite.
Rhode Island bite.
Right.
We're known for our Rhode Island bite.
We are, but we want to get to know everybody one by one, one at a time. I used to come down and would enjoy sitting and talking with Ben Mondor. I loved him very much, and I loved the warmth and hospitality that he and Mike Tamboro project so much. That when I was going to have an office here, I chose to share with Mike Tamboro. He's my roommate. So a Paw Sox veteran of 43 years, and here I am still just barely out of rookie status.
That close a relationship. Well, we appreciate your coming in today.
My pleasure.
Dr. Stenberg, to tell us what's going on with the Paw Sox. Everyone's keeping an eye on, seeing what's going to happen over there. But the season's starting, fireworks every Saturday.
That's
and
right.
Then fanfeedback@pawsox.com.
How about that?
You can provide feedback, and maybe Dr. Charles will respond directly to you.
I would be happy to.
Well, Dr. Stenberg, appreciate your coming in
Thanks.
Today so much.
Thank you.
We will talk soon.